Hello, dear student. Hello, dear students.
Hello, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Can you see the screen, my dear students?
Yes, sir.
Thank you for the reply, dear students. So in the last period, my dear students, we have started studying about the group 13 elements from the P block. Group 13 is known as the boron family. We have studied about their occurrence, and the very important point that we have started studying about this element is about their ionic radius or atomic radius, my dear students. We have seen that when we go down the group, the atomic radius or ionic radius does not increase regularly, especially when it comes to going from aluminium to gallium. What happens if you look into the electronic configuration of aluminium? Aluminium has got neon 3s2 3p1, but you know 3d in aluminium is vacant. But when it comes to the gallium, gallium has got argon 4s2 3d10 and 4p1. So you can easily understand that if we have this kind of shells, this is n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, n is equal to 4. N is equal to 4 has 4s and 4p, and n is equal to 3 has 3s, 3p and 3d. So now when it comes to our gallium, my dear students, please understand it well. When it comes to the gallium, in gallium, the electron after argon, they go to the 4s2 orbital. So in this 4s orbital, my dear student, two electrons are filled. After that, my dear student, some 10 electrons are filled into the 3d. This 10 electron actually goes near to the nucleus, and they are filled after 4s. Please remember this, that these 3d electrons are filled after 4s is filled. So as this 10 electron goes near to the nucleus, at the same time as 10 electrons are added, 10 protons are also added. That is what it increases the nuclear charge by 10 units. So my dear students, as atomic number Z is increased, the nuclear charge has also been increased, but this D and F orbitals, they show the poor screening. And as this nuclear charge is screened by this electron poorly, poor screening. And that is why when the one electron is filled into 4p, my dear students, this electron fill very strong nuclear charge. This electron fill strong nuclear charge. As this electron fills strong nuclear charge, my dear students, first thing that happens is that the distance between this nucleus and this electron is decreased, because this nucleus attracts this electron very strongly, and that is why the size decreases. And that is why the size of aluminium is greater than the size of gallium, or the atomic radii of aluminium is greater than the atomic radii of gallium. The next thing happens is, suppose you want to give some energy and remove this electron. So you need to provide some energy to remove this electron, my dear students. This energy to remove this electron, energy to remove this electron is known as ionization energy. And when this energy is applied, as this 4p electron is strongly attracted by the nuclear charge, it is difficult to remove this electron, or more energy is needed. As compared to remove this 3p electron from aluminium. So when we want to remove this 3p electron by providing energy, suppose we have this energy X, and we want to remove this 4p electron and we need energy, that is Y, then please remember, my dear students, that X is greater than Y. That means the energy required to remove the electron that is present in 3p into the aluminium is less than the energy required to remove the electron from 4p of gallium. And that is why, my dear students, going down the group, going specially from aluminium to gallium, in generally the ionization energy value should decrease, but in case of the aluminium and gallium, when we move from aluminium to gallium, the requirement of energy increases, and that is why the ionization energy for gallium is more than the ionization energy for aluminium. And that is what we have studied into the last period, my dear student, that if we go down the group, what happens? This abnormal behavior we see, we can look into the electronic configuration of aluminium and gallium. We have just seen that in case of the gallium, we have these 3D electrons are filled. So going from aluminium to gallium, size decreases and 10 electrons are filled in the inner core of gallium. Show poor screening. So increased nuclear charge due to the increased atomic number is not overcome by the poor screening, and thus the outermost electron, that is 4p electron, is strongly attracted by the nucleus. That leads to the requirement of more energy to release electron, and thus the ionization enthalpy for gallium is more than the ionization enthalpy of for aluminium. Here we have talked about the first ionization enthalpy, my dear students. Please remember that whatever we have discussed here, it is for the first ionization enthalpy, and that is why we can say that delta IH1 for our gallium is greater than delta IH1 for aluminium. That is what we can say. Same thing happens in case of the indium and thallium. So please have a look to this indium and thallium, my dear students. When it comes to the indium, krypton 5s2, 4d10, 5p1. Then what happens in case of thallium, xenon, first 6s electrons are filled. Then 14 electron goes to the 4f orbital and 10 electron goes to the 5d orbital. And then the last electron goes into the 6p orbital. That is why thallium belongs to the p block. So here, my dear students, you can easily understand that in case of the indium and thallium, the same kind of thing happens. What happens? Let us try to see, my dear students, that what happens here actually. Here, my dear students, if you look into the indium and thallium, my dear students, in indium we have krypton and xenon. In case of the krypton, we have 5s2, 4d10, 5p1. You can easily understand that 5d remains vacant over here. So 5d, which is already present in the shell of krypton, which remains vacant. But when it comes to the thallium, my dear students, the first two electron goes to the 4s orbital. I'm sorry, my dear students, not 4s orbital, but in the 6s orbital. Then, my dear students, 4f is filled and 14 electron goes into the 4f, which is n is equal to 4. Then, my dear students, 5d orbital is filled with 10 electron, where you have n is equal to 5. And then, my dear students, the last electron goes to the 6p orbital, where you have n is equal to 6. So if you really look into the nucleus, and if you look into the various shells, my dear students, here if you have n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, n is equal to 4, n is equal to 5, n is equal to 6, n is equal to 7. Your 6s is present over here. But remember, the 4f is present over here and 5d is present over here. And then, my dear students, you have 6p. So it is easy to understand for you, dear student, that when these two electrons are filled into the 6s, Then after that, some 14 electrons are filled here. And then 10 electrons are filled into the 5D. So you can see that 14 here, 10 here, total 24 electrons are filled into the inner core, inner side, near to the nucleus. By that time, some nuclear charge has also been increased by 24 units. These 24 units of nuclear charge, when one extra electron or one electron is filled into the 6p orbital, my dear students, what happens? This nuclear charge attracts the 6p electron very strongly towards it. And that is why it is very difficult to remove this electron. As compared to this electron which is present into the 5p. So when we compare the ease of removing the electron from 6p1 and when we compare the ease of removing electron from 5p1, in case of the thallium, this 6p electron is difficult to be removed. It requires more energy. So as it requires more energy to be removed, my dear students, what happens? This ionization energy for thallium is more than the ionization energy for indium. So this is how, my dear students, it is easy to understand that going from indium to thallium, atomic number is increased. As atomic number is increased, number of protons in the nucleus are also increased. As the number of proton increases, my dear students, what happens? The ionic or the nuclear charge which attracts the electron has also been increased. As 14 electrons goes into the 4F and 10 electron goes into the 5D. So nuclear charge has been increased too. Apart from this, after filling 2 electrons in excess, 14 electron goes into 4F and 10 electron goes into 5D, which are 24 electron fill into the inner shell. More, this 24 electron goes more near to the nucleus. Even due to their shape, F and D orbital cannot screen the outermost 6p1 electron properly. Thus, 6p1 electron is poorly screened and that is attracted strongly by the nucleus and requires more energy to remove this electron which is present into the 6p1. Thus, the first ionization enthalpy of thallium is more than the first ionization enthalpy of indium. We know that the order of ionization enthalpy. Now, my dear students, this is how we can explain the first ionization enthalpy of thallium is more than the first ionization enthalpy of indium. Now we have the second point to study, my dear students, that we have studied about first ionization enthalpy, second ionization enthalpy, and third ionization enthalpy. As the first ionization enthalpy is the removal of electron from the neutral atom, that gives m plus one electron. Then in second ionization enthalpy, the positively charged plus one ion gives plus two ion and one electron is removed. And then, my dear students, in the next step, when we have plus two charge on the ion and that plus two charge removes one electron and makes plus three ion. So each time as the first ionization enthalpy, and if you look into the second ionization enthalpy, as the electron needs to be removed from the plus one charge ion, it is difficult and more energy is needed. But in case of the third ionization enthalpy, it is even very difficult because we need to remove the electron from the plus two charge ion. So the order for the ionization enthalpy, we can easily write that first ionization enthalpy is less than the second ionization enthalpy, is less than the third ionization enthalpy. As we have already discussed, my dear students, that some of the first three ionization enthalpy, that is delta I H1, delta I H2, and delta I H3 is very high for this element that belongs to the group 13, but still they show the plus three oxidation state. Now, my dear students, we want to study about the electronegativity of this group 13 elements. My dear students, if you could not understand anything in between, you can stop me and ask. Generally, going down the group, the value of electronegativity decreases. But in group 13 element, going down the group from boron to aluminium, the value decreases. That is from 2.0 to 1.5. But then marginal increase in electronegativity is being observed. So the electronegativity of gallium is 1.6, indium is 1.7, and thallium is 1.8. So exactly opposite, going down the group here, the electronegativity value increases, but the increase is in a very small amount. Remember that going from boron to aluminium, the electronegativity generally decreases. Now, my dear students, we want to study about the physical properties. Boron is a non-metallic in nature. It is extremely hard and black colored solid. It exists in many allotropic forms. Due to very strong crystalline lattice, boron has unusually high melting point. Please remember, the melting point of boron is very high. Rest of the members are soft metals with low melting point and high electrical conductivity. Please remember that aluminium, gallium, indium, and thallium, they are metals and they conduct electricity well. It is worthwhile to note that gallium with unusually low melting point at 303 Kelvin could exist in a liquid state at room temperature during the month of summers. So my dear students, as I have already explained, the melting point of gallium is even less than our body temperature, and that is why it can melt in our fist. So the gallium can exist in liquid state during the summer. Its high boiling point, that is 2673 Kelvin, makes it useful material for measuring the high temperatures. Now please remember, my dear students, that melting point of mercury is less than the melting point of our gallium. This mercury is used to measure temperature, and that is why it is used into the thermometers. But think that we want to measure the very high temperatures. So if we want to measure the very high temperatures, mercury will go into the vapor, or you will get the vapor of the mercury at those very high temperatures. But in case of those temperatures which are below 2673 Kelvin, gallium can be utilized to measure such high temperatures up to 2676 Kelvin. So when mercury becomes vapor, our gallium still remains liquid, and that is why gallium in the liquid form is utilized to measure the temperatures, and the thermometer which are made by using gallium, they can be utilized to measure the high temperatures that are below 2676 Kelvin. So this is how, my dear students, when mercury fails to measure the high temperatures, in that cases, gallium thermometers are used to measure such high temperatures. Density of the elements increases down the group. So as we go down the group, my dear students, from boron, aluminium, gallium, indium, and thallium, the density of this element increases down the group from boron to the thallium. So please remember, if we go down the group in group number 13 elements, the density increases. Now, my dear students, we are going to study about the chemical properties. First, we should study about the oxidation state and their strength in chemical reactivity. Due to small size of boron, the sum of its first three ionization enthalpy is very high. This prevents boron from plus three ions and forces it to form the only covalent compounds. And as boron forms the covalent compound, we consider it as a non-metal. But as we move from boron to aluminium, the sum of the first three ionization enthalpy is very high. This prevents it from plus three ions and forces to make only covalent compounds. This is what it is true in case of the boron. But let us study further. But as we move from boron to aluminium, the sum of the first three ionization enthalpies The sum of the first three Hanessian enthalpies of aluminium considerably decreases. Please remember, my dear students, that as you move from boron to aluminium, see, boron makes covalent bonds. But as we move from boron to aluminium, the sum of delta IH1 plus delta IH2 plus delta IH3 decreases. And it decreases to the great extent that and is therefore our aluminium is able to form Al plus 3 ions. In fact, gallium is highly electropositive metal, and thus gallium can also form Ga plus 3 ions. So going down the group, apart from boron, all the other elements can make plus 3 ions. But remember, my dear students, that due to the inert pair effect, in case of the thallium, the plus 3 oxidation state is less stable than the plus 1 oxidation state. But in this three, aluminium, gallium and thallium, plus 3 oxidation state is more stable than plus 1 oxidation state. In fact, aluminium does not show plus 1 oxidation state. So there are no compounds of aluminium available which have the plus 1 oxidation state. Plus 1 oxidation state is well shown by the indium and thallium. Now let's move forward. However, down the group, due to the poor shielding effect of intervening d and f orbitals, the increased effective nuclear charge holds the ns electron tightly, which is responsible for the inert pair effect and thereby restricting their participation in the bonding. As a result of this, p orbital electrons may be involved in the bonding. In fact, gallium, indium and thallium, both plus 1 and plus 3 oxidation state are observed. The relative stability of plus 1 oxidation state progressively increases from heavier elements in order of plus oxidation state relative stability. You can see here that for plus 1 oxidation state, aluminium does not show plus 1 oxidation state, thallium show plus 1 oxidation state, and it is most stable in plus 1 oxidation state. Then as we move from aluminium to gallium, the stability of plus 1 oxidation state increases. Going from gallium to indium, plus 1 oxidation state increases, and it is maximum stable in case of thallium. In thallium, plus 1 oxidation state is predominant. Most of the compounds of thallium are found into the plus 1 oxidation state, my dear students. But if you look into the indium will mostly be found into the plus 3 oxidation state. As plus 3 oxidation state in thallium is highly oxidizing in character. So my dear students, our plus 3, Tl plus 3 will be Tl plus 3 will be reduced to Tl plus 1 easily. So that is why it has got reduced, and that is why Tl plus 3 is highly oxidizing in character. The compound in plus 1 oxidation state, as expected from energy consideration, are more ionic than those in plus 3 oxidation state. Now please remember, this is very interesting thing, my dear students. According to the Fajans rule, the more is the charge density, the more is the charge density. Now what is the charge density? Charge density is equal to charge divided by volume. So as you go down the group, or as you look into this, my dear students, the more is the charge density, more is the ability to polarize. More is the ability to polarize. Ability to polarize. More is the ability to polarize the other elements. This ability to polarize is also known as the polarizing power. So my dear students, here what happens, that if you have plus 1 charge and if you have plus 3 charge, plus 3 charge is more than plus 1 charge, and that is why in plus 3 charge there is more polarizing power. As the plus 3 charge has more polarizing power, this plus 3 charge, my dear students, will definitely cause more polarizing to the negative ion. And as the negative ion is more polarized, it causes covalent character. So as the negative ion can be more polarized by the plus 3 oxidation state, it causes the covalent character, and that is why the higher oxidation state, that is the compound in plus 3 oxidation state, they are more covalent, and the compounds in plus 1 oxidation state, they are more ionic in nature. That is what it is easy to understand using the Fajans rule. In trivalent state, my dear students, the number of electrons around the central atom in the molecule of the compound of these elements, for example, boron in case of the BF3 will be only 6. If you look into the structure of BF3, my dear students, there will be only 6 electrons present in case of the boron, but our fluorine will have the 8 electrons. So here you can see that this boron has only 6 electrons, and that is why it is incomplete octet. Please remember, the boron has got incomplete octet because it has only 6 electrons present into them. Such electron deficient molecules have a tendency to accept pair of electrons. So these electron deficient compounds, they accept the pair of electron, and to achieve the stable electronic configuration, or we can say to achieve the octet. And thus they behave like Lewis acid. Lewis acids are the compounds that accept the electrons. So these compounds like BF3 or BCl3 or AlCl3, these all can behave like Lewis acid, and that is why they are used. Even BH3 or you can say B2H6, they are the compounds which have electron deficient central atom, and that is why they behave like Lewis acid, and that is why they are also used into the Friedel-Crafts reactions. The tendency to behave as a Lewis acid decreases with the increase in the size down the group. So my dear students, as we go down the group, the behavior like Lewis acid decreases. So as we go down the group, my dear students, the acidic character decreases for the plus 3 oxidation state. BCl3 easily accept a lone pair from the lone pair of electron from the ammonia and make the compound BCl3NH3. So it is a complex that is formed where the bond from NH3 to B takes place, and it is a directional bond. This lone pair of electron is accepted by boron, and that is why this is a directional bond. This bond is a directional bond, my dear students, a directional bond, or we can say it is the coordinate covalent bond. For making this bond, both the electrons are given by N. So it is not exactly the covalent bond, but it is called a coordinate covalent bond. Bond is made by sharing the electrons, but the electrons which are donated by only nitrogen. So this is how, my dear students, by accepting the lone pair from ammonia, the planar, that is sp2 hybridized BCl3, turns out to be sp3 hybridized, and tetrahedral shape of NH3 BCl3, which is a complex compound. AlCl3 achieves a stability by forming a dimer. Please remember, my dear students, that two molecules of AlCl3, let's not say 2 moles, but let's write 2 molecules of AlCl3. 2 AlCl3 combines with each other to form Al2Cl6. You can see here that this is Al, this is Al2. Then you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. This is how Al2Cl6 is formed. In Al2Cl6, my dear students, we have 1 AlCl3 molecule. You can see this is 1 AlCl3 molecule. We have the another AlCl3 molecules, but this Cl and Al and this Cl and this Al, they make a bond, and these bonds are known as the bridge bond. Bridge bond. And that is why this is what it is known as the bridge dimer. BRI, bridge dimer. So my dear students, aluminium, as it has got only 6 electron, it has got incomplete octet. What happens, this aluminium takes, or aluminium makes the bridge bond between aluminium and Cl of the another AlCl3. Another aluminium make bridge bond between this aluminium and other Cl of the other AlCl3, and thus the dimer, dimer is the combination of two molecules takes place, and that is why we can have this bond length also little longer. You can understand this bridge bond by looking into the bond length, my dear students. If you look into the bond length here, this bond is 206 picometer long. This bond is 206 picometer long, whereas this bond is 221 picometer long. It shows that this bond is a bridge bond. And that is why this angle, which was 118 degree, has been changed to 101 degree and 79 degree. So this bond angle has been changed to 79 degree, and that is why the change into the bond length as well as the bond angle shows that here the bridge bond is formed. In trivalent state, most of the compound being covalent are hydrolyzed in water. So my dear students, when these compounds which are of which are having the central atom to have plus 3 oxidation state, they undergo a process of hydrolysis. Please remember, my dear students, that hydrolysis is the process of addition of water by dividing the water into either H plus and OH minus or H2N oxygen. So for example, here the trichlorides on hydrolysis with water gives tetrahedral MOH4 minus species. So when these elements, or when these compounds with a plus 3 oxidation state, for example, if you have BCl3, it will hydrolyze with water to give BOH4 minus. If you have AlCl3, then it will probably form AlOH4 minus. So this is how these compounds which are present in the plus 3 oxidation state of the central atom, they undergo the process of hydrolysis and they form this kind of MOH4 kind of species. But my dear students, aluminium has got the vacant d orbital, and that is why due to the process of hydrolysis, my dear students, aluminium also form one typical kind of compound. Let us study about that. But aluminium chloride in acidified aqueous solution forms octahedral AlH2O6 plus 3. Let us understand how this AlH2O6 plus 3 is formed. In this complex ion, 3D orbitals of aluminium are involved, and the hybridization is sp3d2. So you know that, my dear students, the electronic configuration of aluminium is neon 3s2 3p1. Here you can see that these 3D orbitals are absolutely vacant. When aluminium become aluminium plus 3 by removing the 3 electrons which are present into 2 electrons from 3s and 1 electron from 3p, we have aluminium plus 3 ion with the electronic configuration neon 3s0, 3p0, 3d0. So now, my dear students, this H2O with lone pair on oxygen come and put their lone pair inside the 6 vacant orbitals of aluminium plus 3 ion, that is 1 from 3s, this is all 3p, 3px, 3py, 3pz, and these 2 of d orbitals are also used. Thus, by hybridization here, we can see that sp3d2 hybridization takes place, and these water molecules are arranged around the aluminium in the octahedral manner. You can see the octahedral shape of aluminium. All 5 aluminium with 5 H2O are in the same plane, and one and another is above and under. So this is how, my dear students, we can understand the octahedral shape here, and thus the octahedral shape is understood. So this is how the coordinate covalent bonds are formed, as the electrons are given by oxygen of water, for making this bond, and that is why this kind of bonds are known as the coordinate covalent bond, and this is how AlH2O6 minus 3 can be formed. So this is how, my dear students, we understand this. Or even I think it should be plus 3, I am sorry, it should not be the minus 3, my dear students, but as aluminium is plus 3, we should write it here AlH2O6 plus 3. Yeah, it's a plus 3, my dear students. So because aluminium is plus 3, that is these water molecules do not have any charge, and that is how this this complex ions which is formed, which will have the plus 3 oxidation state. Now we have a problem to solve, my dear students. The standard electrode potential value of E0 for aluminium plus 3 oblique aluminium is minus 1.66 volt, and that of Ti plus 3 oblique Tl is 1.26 volt. You can see that one value is negative, another value is positive. Predict about the formation of M plus 3 ions in solution and compare the electropositive character of two metals. Now let me once again explain you, my dear students. The more negative is the value of the electrode potential, the more is the stability of positive ion. Generally, if the value is negative, the stability of positive ion is more in the reduced form as well as the oxidized form. So here if you see that TL plus 3 is oxidized and TL is a reduced form. Same way if you look into the aluminium plus 3 is oxidized form and aluminium is reduced form. So the value for E0 is minus 1.66 for aluminium, and value for thallium plus 3 oblique thallium is plus 1.26. That means the possibility of forming thallium plus 3 is very much less, whereas the possibility of forming aluminium plus 3 is quite higher, because the value of electrode potential is negative. So here in case of the aluminium and aluminium plus 3, aluminium plus 3 is more stable than aluminium, but in case into the aqueous solution, but in case of the thallium plus 3 oblique thallium, thallium atom is more stable as compared to the thallium plus 3 ion. That is what it is being explained by the positive electrode potential value. So this is how, my dear students, we can answer this question very easily without any hesitation, looking into the values of the electrode potential. So let's understand it, and let us read what the answers is given, my dear students. Let's look into the answer. The standard electrode potential value for two half cell reaction suggests that aluminium has high tendency to make Al plus 3 aqueous ions, whereas thallium plus 3 is not only unstable in solution, but it's powerful oxidizing agent also. That means Al plus 3, if it is available in the aqueous solution, it will definitely take 3 electrons from the ion and form Tl solid. This is what it happens, because it is a powerful oxidizing agent. So those ions which are powerful oxidizing agent, their electrode potential will have the positive value. Please remember this. Thus Tl plus 1 is more stable in solution than Tl plus 3. Aluminium being able to form plus 3 ions easily is more electropositive than thallium. So this is what we can easily understand about this aluminium and thallium, my dear students. We will discuss the reactivity towards air into the next period, my dear students. I hope you have understood everything. If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Dear students, do you have any doubt? Is there anyone who would like to ask me something? Please reply. Hello.
Can I? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
What? Yes, beta. Do you want to ask something, or you do not have any doubt?
No, sir. No doubt.
Okay, then let's finish the class here.
No, sir.
And we'll meet into the next class.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome, welcome. Dear child, welcome.